All right, it's Saturday, August 1st, 2020, and my voice is a little muffled because I've got my COVID-19 mask on, but I'm here in the parking lot of the Henry Ford Museum in Dearborn, Michigan, and I think the last time I was here was probably in 2006, so it's time to have another visit. It's kind of interesting. It's a momentous moment for me. Even though I could have started doing so a few years ago, I always resisted the option to consider myself a senior citizen and take advantage of lower prices and so on. But I decided, starting with this week-long trip that I'm starting with here, I'm going to do that. Officially allow myself to be a senior citizen. It's only a couple of bucks discount on the price. Right up here we have a Wright Brothers style flyer. I don't see anything saying whether it's a repro or not. I presume it is. They do show movies here at the museum, have at least one theater, but they're closed either for maintenance or because of the COVID-19 situation. And they've got this promenade here. My general impression of this museum the last time I visited it was that it had diminished in quality quite a lot since the previous time I'd visited it, probably in the 80s. It seemed like they'd dumbed down a lot of the exhibits to the lowest common denominator and thereby reduced their interest to more inquisitive people. But we'll see, because they're constantly evolving, this place. We've got the Driving America exhibit, Heroes of the Sky, might as well start here. The Model T of the Sky, the 1926 Ford Flivver. Have some size comparisons here. They have a typical full-sized, well, they say it's full-sized, it doesn't look like it really is, maybe a little bit smaller than real, cross-section of a 737, comparing it to a DC-3, which does seem to be pretty much real. Full-sized size comparisons with a 737 and a DC-3 and a Ford tri-motor. And here we have a Ford Trimotor. One of my favorite airplanes, even though I've only had a chance to fly on one once at the EAA Museum. Here. Oh, can't go there. The Ford Trimotor is considered to be the first commercially successful all-metal aircraft. Opened a new era in commercial aviation in the late 1920s. I always like the open engines, and the gauges for the engines are right on the engines. The pilot has to look out the window at the side of the engine to see the gauges. Very direct. Not so good at night, maybe. Maybe he had a flashlight. And then the flight controls come right out the side of the fuselage and have open cables that just go right up into the wing. And then some of them, of course, run back along the top of the fuselage to the tail. This is a 1927 Boeing 40B2. Get a little further away for a better view of it. You have a Liberty engine here and a Wasp engine over there. ...1903 Wright Flyer. Yeah, this is a replica built by Ken Hyde in 2003. They do have an upper level for different views of the aircraft. An exhibit on barnstorming. This is a 1917 Curtis JN4D Canuck. Or is that the one that's upside down? Let's see. I think that's this one up here. Here goes, interesting. It doesn't say what this aircraft is. I don't see any signs saying what it is. And I'm not as good with the old biplanes to identify all the different models. This is a Fokker tri-motor. Similar in many ways to the Ford tri-motor, but different in a number of ways. Especially with the wing overhanging the cockpit as it does. And I seem to remember that the Fokkers had wooden wings as opposed to the tri-motor's metal wings. Anyway, this is a 1925 Fokker F7 or VII tri-motor. Metal tubing and fabric fuselage wooden wings. And what do we have here? This is a 1920 Dayton Wright RB1. Very streamlined for the era. Built out of balsa wood, the fuselage and wings, and covered with plywood and varnished linen. Built by the Dayton Wright Company in Dayton, Ohio. Wonder if that's one of the only human-carrying airplanes to actually be built out of balsa wood. I don't recall hearing of any others. This is a 1929 Lockheed Vega in the dark. Set up in the Amelia Earhart paint scheme. This is a 1927 Stinson Detroiter. Wooden wings, tubular steel fuselage. Nothing like having all your exhibits in the dark, right? I'm guessing this is a replica 1927 Ryan NYP Spirit of St. Louis. This is a working replica of Lindbergh's plane. It's a Ryan B1 Brougham modified to fly in the 1957 movie The Spirit of St. Louis. It was later purchased by actor Jimmy Stewart, who played Lindbergh in the movie. Here's some I haven't seen from the ground level yet. There is a 1910 Blériot 11 or XI. And a 1931 Pitcairn PCA2 autogyro. So we're back down here by the 1910 Blériot 11. It doesn't say anything about this as a repro. I think it's an original one. It was the smallest, lightest plane built up to that time. Pilot sat out in the open without even a seat belt or safety restraints. And there's the Pitcairn autogyro again. What do we have down here? Oh, it's a Gormulian Jeffrey 1896 Rambler. This is something the when their 1901 glider didn't fly as expected, the Wrights mounted the testing device on a bicycle. Brothers learned that the standard data used to design their wings was incorrect, so they built a wind tunnel to recalculate the data.
They have spare wheel that comes with it. It's a Rambler.
So you really have to like crouch over though for that one.
That's why I need the high profile big boy bars for the low riders.
So this guy down here, which was not identified upstairs, is a 1939 Vought Sikorsky VS-300A. It's the only one of its kind. This was the first helicopter to use a practical single rotor design. Donated by Sikorsky to the museum. Pretty sure I've seen either still photos or old movie reel footage of this flying. So here's a DC-3, which we've spotted a little bit of here and there. I've only flown on DC-3s, was it three times now? I have videos of two of those flights on YouTube. One of them is in the military C-47, and the other one is an actual commercial DC-3 operating out of Oakland Airport near San Francisco. This is the Made in America gallery. These parts, or these exhibits here, are all parts of various power generating apparatus. This is a stationary steam engine from 1906. It saved money by using the steam twice, first in one cylinder, then in a second. These were known as compound engines. These are all from the late 1800s up into the 1920s that these were popular. And this is a Corning glass ribbon machine from 1928. Revolutionized the light bulb production when it was introduced in the 1920s. Takes a ribbon of molten glass and blows it into moving molds, making 600 or 700 glass casings a minute. It reduced the cost of light bulbs and put glass blowers out of work. This is a stationary steam engine dating from around 1855. It's just a stylistic touch that the frame is made in this sort of Victorian Gothic style. This is another stationary steam engine from around 1880. It's a compact design by the New Haven Manufacturing Company. This is another stationary steam engine from about 1862. This is an Edison General Electric Company Schenectady Works 200 kilowatt dynamo, unit number 4. And this is number 3. Here's some other views of what we've already seen. And here's another steam engine, but this is a portable design built around 1867. And this is another stationary steam engine from about 1888. It's also set up with a dynamo over here for generation of electricity. A stationary steam engine from 1879. Harris Hoff Manufacturing Company, Bristol, Rhode Island. And then various tools of the engineers, our operating engineers' trade. Nice set of drafting instruments. We've already seen this one coming in. Here's a pretty big bruiser. And this is a marine steam engine from 1875. This huge engine was used in two different Great Lakes cargo ships during its 50 years of operation. This is a I think this is a water turbine. I'm not sure. Yeah, this is a water turbine and electric generator from 1903. That's the generator over on the left, so this has got to be the turbine over on the right. And this is an electric generator from 1897. Generated alternating current. Used to power the Bunker Hill and Sullivan Silver Mine in Idaho. More tools of the engineer's trade and just general things like padlocks and drills, chisels, measuring instruments, valves, hinges, pliers, flashlights and electrical sockets. And this is a model of a steeple compound marine engine from 1872. Let's take another look at this guy here. A model of a General Electric turbine as used in power plants, and an 1893 electric motor for alternating current, a junction box from 1890, watertight cast iron box used to join together two sets of wires underground, and here's a 1895 AC generator. And an electric arc lamp and generator. Where's the arc lamp? Oh, it's up there. There's the generator. Old power meter. A model of Edison's 1880 electric train. And, I don't know what that is. I think that's another, they call it an electric arc lamp. Doesn't look very lamp-like to me, but I do see what might be two contacts there. So maybe, yeah, it arcs between those two. Two rails right there. and accompanying generator. Hook it up to the belt from a power source. And here's some more arc lamp systems, generators of various sorts, big knife switch. Here's a pretty ginormous flywheel. Here's a stationary steam engine from 1855. This is a Corliss model by George Corliss. And here's a stationary steam engine from 1880. This was a competitor of the Corliss engine by Noble Green, made by the Providence Steam Engine Company, and used in Kirby's Mill, Willimantic, Connecticut. Probably mispronounced that. Here's a model of a typical machine shop using a boiler here and running a steam engine stationary, and then a large belt going up to the overhead drive shafts, and then feeding off those with belts coming down to the individual tools. Obviously, there's a lathe and a drill press and some milling machines and a grinder. That one might be a stamping machine of some sort. Can't really tell exactly what it is. I used to know a guy in northwestern Ohio, name of Lowell Kennedy, who was one of the most magnificent machinists I'd ever encountered or heard about, who had an old shop, the Kennedy Machine Shop, and he had overhead belt-driven tools and made a lot of reproductions of old apparatus and machines using those tools. Even the heating of the place was vintage. Let's see, I don't think I covered this one. Stationary steam engine cylinder, just the cylinder, no flywheel, from 1855. So let's see, I think that's most of this, but we have to go to the back of it. Alternatives to steam power from 1870 to 1885. As it says, steam engines were very useful, but they're not perfect. They were expensive, their boilers could explode. Smoke from the boilers caused pollution. Cities often required engine operators to be licensed. So they looked for alternatives. Obviously you had water-operated motors. This one from 1880. and a hot air engine from 1870. And the Brayton kerosene engine from 1878. An electric motor. And the Otto engine from 1883. Nikolaus Otto from Europe. Internal combustion. And this looks, what is it, a water wheel? Nope, I think it looks like a steam engine. We'll figure it out. This is a Watt rotative steam engine from 1788. It's a full-scale replica. It's not the real McCoy. You could spend a lot of time in here just perusing all the very easily observable mechanical devices in here in great detail if you really are so inclined. But for this video, I'm not going to indulge myself like that. The Maudsley precision lathe from 1816, used for clock makers and instrument makers. Some Wedgwood pottery and Sheffield plate candlesticks. And there's a Maudsley production lathe from 1804. With a big sign blocking the view of it. Looks like a little spinning wheel. Spinning wheel for cotton or flax from 1795. This one was just sold as a small parlor accessory for hand spinning as a hobby rather than a necessity. And here's the spinning jenny from 1800. Allowed one person to spin 32 pieces of yarn at once. And there's a model of a small steam engine from 1810. And this is a Watt pumping engine from 1811. There's the pump. So for water pumping for cities and so on. This was what used in Birmingham, England for as a part of a water pumping station. And here are some nice models, which are used to explain steam engine operation. Some more of them over here. I visited the Engineerium in Brighton England a couple of times. I think they're closed now, but they used to be an old pumping station. Had a couple of these big pumping engines in them. And then they had a whole display of these little, actually mostly working, miniature models of various kinds of steam engine. It was a great place for anybody with an engineering, an interest in engineering of any sort, really. I really don't know what happened to the collection after they closed. Okay, let's see what this big guy is. This is the Highland Park Plant engine generator, built in 1912, used at Ford's Highland Park Plant in Highland Park, Michigan, from 1912 to 1930. Generated 4,000 kilowatts at 250 volts DC. They built 9 of these engines for the powering their production plant. This is all of a piece here. Combination gas steam. Yeah, combination gas steam engine built by the Hooven Owens Rentschler Company of Hamilton, Ohio for the Ford Motor Company. Have the bearings opened up here for service. Well, these aren't bearings. These are the cams for the engine. This has got to be the equivalent of a timing shaft of sorts. There's your large piston, I think. This has got to weigh many tons, geez. Great big generator over there. All your electrical. Let's see, what do we have here? Water pressure, RPMs, DC amps, receiver, something or another. Steam, I guess those are pressure, receiver pressure, steam pressure, vacuum, air pressure. And, big wheels to control it with, apparently. Get past the glare. You get a couple of shin bangers here. Gotta watch it. Looks like the crank heads here just slide on these. That's the way it looks. Just a plate that slides along this rail here, or this curved bed. That's interesting. And then there's the flywheel. And the very large generator. And this is the underside of that same engine with another some parts that are not currently on the engine. Can't get another view of this, it looks like. I thought maybe they had a way to get down there into the lower level, but no. Oh, let's see. I think I can go around this way. Have here. This looks to be a bit older with its wooden frame. Cycloidal engine from 1805. This is probably made by Bradley's Foundry in Stourbridge, England. It's 4 horsepower. And this other guy here is a Thomas Horn engine from 1850. And a McNaught compound engine from 1873. And a Dixon engine from 1811. This has got to be another pumping engine. Let's see. A Moira engine from 1821. Old technologies survive long after newer ones are invented. If a machine is economical, it's kept. Since the owners of the Newcomen engine fueled it with waste coal, they had no need for more efficient, more complex engines. Although this engine was obsolete technologically even when it was built, it nevertheless worked well and was still being used in 1929. Made by the Moira Colliery Company in Moira, England. It's unclear what the horsepower is. And this is another Newcomen engine from 1760, the oldest surviving steam engine in the world. It was used to pump water out of deep mine in England. Thomas Newcomen designed the first truly successful steam engine around 1710. Lots of parts are pretty eroded, but it looks fairly complete. This appears to be the pump here. And then your, I guess that's your cylinder. And then the shaft goes up to the crank up above. Or that might be a control valve there. This looks like it's the pump over here. Yeah. So pump it up to here from way down below, and it's hard to tell which direction that goes. That might actually, anyway, it looks like the majority of the water runs out through that sluice there. There's the boiler. Shotguns. Target rifles. Pepper boxes and Allens. American handguns. Colt handguns. Smith & Wesson handguns. Handmade rifles. Some of those look like old squirrely rifles, don't they? More handmade rifles. Some of these are real buttes. All sorts of carefully inlaid pieces of metal and bone and horn and so on them. Factory made rifles. And more shotguns, some really long shotguns.
Look at that shot.
Double barrel shot, 1810. I mean, 1840. Yep. Double barrel shot.
Whitnall. Powder horns and flasks. And some firearm accessories. And now we're back to the engines. Typical rural wind turbine. I'm not sure it's a wind fan, really. I don't think it qualifies as it's not a turbine exactly, but you can derive quite a bit of power from these. You can use them for pumping, of course, or as this one has, it has a gear reduction and then a belt, and this one's set up with a saw. So they call these windmills, and I always thought that was kind of a misnomer because there's no milling going on. But apparently that's the name they go with. This one overhead was made around 1910. Made, dozens of companies made these, but mostly they were pretty much like this. They were made in standard sizes, could be broken down for convenient transport by train or horse-drawn wagon. The company that made this one, the Air Motor Company of Chicago, also made pump saws, corn shellers, and other machines for use with its mills. Probably like this one. Here's, let's see, did we see these before? Yes, we did. Walked past this already. And here's a water turbine from 1895. These generate a lot more power from a given amount of water than a water wheel would. It has the curved blades and the jet nozzles. There's a water wheel from about 1977. Okay, so we've now seen two or three of the galleries. This is the Your Place in Time, 20th Century America. A little theater in here, showing the Great Train Robbery, the Bandit King, the Burglar's Slide for Life, A Race for a Kiss, and Raffles the Dog. Nickelodeon.
Just a slight difficulty without equipment. Meanwhile, if you would like to present a Greenfield Village, solving your pleasure.
Mr. Brunetti, this is the second time today. It's a full house.
Don't worry. I fix it. You give me 5 minutes,
but what am I supposed to tell these people?
I fix it.
It's a 1917 Overland. Kodak Brownie. The Pure Food and Drug Act of 1906. Candlestick telephone from 1904. Set of Tinker Toys from 1914. Let's see what we got here. An electric iron from 1915. A four-slice toaster from 1917. And an electric siphonator or coffee pot, 1919.
What time down here?
You folks been here before? Yeah, so the way that section works, there's a
routine. Hair remover, sheer hair remover. Hollywood souvenir store. Sort of a representative newsstand. October 30th, 1938, when the War of the Worlds was broadcast. People in the 1930s and 40s relied on their radios for entertainment and news. They thought that broadcasters would tell them the truth. But Orson Welles' hair-raising broadcast of War of the Worlds proved you couldn't always believe what you heard. So it's just supposed to be a typical living room. 1950s teens. Canteens, bombs. It's a metal drive from the war. Scrap metal drive, worn out tires. Uncle Sam needs your discarded silk and nylon stockings for gunpowder bags. This is an old Motorola television from 1950. Big screen. I have one of these cans of emergency drinking water. Cold War relic. But I bought mine at the Titan Missile Museum near Tucson. There's probably tons of these things still available. They made so many of them. Some earlier uses of plastics in the home. Sherman's third grade. A geodesic structure intended for communal living from 1973. The whole Earth catalog and all that good stuff. Just kind of expecting to see a whole Earth catalog in there. Gotta have a copy of Dune on the table. They just had a Mighty Mouse cartoon on. I used to watch that. Oh. no cyclamates. You add real sugar to your Kool-Aid instead of using the dreaded cyclamates. Sucaril. Sweeten it with Sucaril. Birth control and the pill. Enjoy tasteless tab.
Another good
one. I remember all of this stuff. I remember the lunch boxes, I remember the thermos, the piece of paper.
Pet rock is like love.
Brings back memories, although this looks more like a girl's room, but a lot of similarities there. Tour of the Dymaxian House. I did a video not long ago on a couple of tensegrity projects that I worked on, which were something that Buckminster Fuller promoted or dealt with at least. And one of his ideas was the Dymaxian House. Our competitors often offer old-fashioned square houses of wood and brick. No new ideas here. We're going to use the Vacuum Concrete Company, the Holmiola, Johnson Contracting Company, Gunnison Homes, but they're square houses. You want to get the Dymaxian House. The circular house is the home of the future. And there it is. It's always been one of my favorite things here. Dymaxian House is a permanent fireproof home designed to take advantage of 20th century materials and manufacturing technology. Interior pods and walls can be moved to change sizes of rooms. A central mast goes up first and the rest of the lightweight house hangs from this pole. Air is circulated throughout the house every 6 minutes. Single unit bathroom is dropped in on site. Evolving shelves nearly completed. checking ventilation screens. Mr. Buckminster Fuller examining the aluminum roof core. Riveting the ventilator. Affixing Naga hide and artificial leather to the inside wall. Riveting aluminum skid. Fearless Cynthia Lacey, Vice President of Fuller Houses, climbing the central mast to help the rigging. And walking on scaffolding under the rooftop ventilator, way up high. All right, let's go in. To the Dymaxion House. I guess I should have been reading these signs. Fuller Houses Incorporated, the Dymaxion House, 1,017 square feet of living space. Whoopee! There's a nice overhead view. Got your two-bed bedroom. I guess that's the master bedroom. That's probably the bathroom. Living area, etc. Doesn't actually look that big. Spacious living and dining room. There's room for everyone. As long as all you want to do is sit and not do anything. Metal bathrooms, round corners, a breeze to clean. Air ventilation system provides comfort all year. Modern kitchen, attractive and efficient. And tiny. Built-in revolving closets and evolving shelves. No need for dressers. Two bedrooms, cozy and stylish. Cozy is the operative word. Actually, the living room doesn't look that bad. Combination, got the central fireplace over there. Dining area for four people. That's about all you could do in here. A reasonable living room, really, when you get down to it. Sofa, a couple easy chairs, table. That's about all the room there is. So are we supposed to go in here? No, it's closed. Kind of thought it was. So there's our modern and stylish all-in-one kitchen with a... There the light comes on. A very small sink for a kitchen. And the stove area looks really compact, almost like a camping style and size. Very limited storage, but hey. Walk around the corner from the kitchen and you've got a room which is probably supposed to be a bedroom. And it looks like the bathroom is probably supposed to be there, but it's not there. Maybe they let us go in here, but I don't see anybody going in. I think they used to let you go through here. I have a memory of going through it. Can't read any of the signs, they're too far away. The ramp here that we're on goes down just at the wrong time. You can't see what you're looking at. This would be an okay house for a single person. Can't get any higher than that. Guess I have to walk around the other way. The stiffening structure on this is kind of interesting. It's got a lot of cables under tension with turnbuckles to tighten it up, which kind of crisscrosses the windows a little bit. Not too obtrusive, but still, it's there. It's sort of a bummer that you can't go around the other side. They've got the observation ramp, but you can't go around there, apparently. Huh. I don't know why not. Oh well. I think I'm going the wrong direction. I'm supposed to go this way. Was there a way out here or not? I don't remember. Yes, there is. Yeah, it's that little area. For some reason, they're not letting people go there. Oh well, that was going to be my better view of the bedroom. So now we're into the agriculture and the environment exhibit. This is a New Holland TR-70 axial flow combine from 1975. I think that's set up for corn. Combine stands for combination harvester. It does all the harvesting steps in one machine, and you could change the heads out on the front here and change a few parts inside and set them up for different crops. So the same machine that did corn could do, for example, soybeans and various other crops. Enclosed, air-conditioned and heated cab. Often you end up doing your harvesting in the fall, and it can be cold, and they have to usually get the harvesting done in a very small amount of time, you know, before freezes, between rains, so things don't rot, and you want to put the crops away dry, not wet. And so often you see the farmers out working all night long to squeeze in the harvesting while the weather allows. So you have to have a fairly comfortable environment. I myself operated a really old John Deere combine on our family farm for one season only, and I was usually only a volunteer laborer. I'd go up whenever I had a chance to help out because we didn't live there. And mostly I was there earlier in the summer, and I didn't do a lot of harvesting. But we did have a gleaner and a John Deere combine, and the John Deere one did not have a closed cab. You're just out in the breeze. I never did get to run the gleaner. Anyway, this is a corn picker and husker from 1928. So it's really kind of like the front end of the combine there. And corn husking pegs and hooks from the, used from the early 1800s into the 1920s, certainly, when this used to be done by hand. Large groups of people would all gather together and wander out there and husk the corn. These are corn shellers, hand-operated corn shellers. And here's a Macy Harris self-propelled combine. This one does have sort of an open cab. It has some provision for keeping the sun and the rain off of you, but not much. This one's from, this is a Model 20 from 1938. This one is, it looks like they're set up for wheat on this one. Very primitive. But these things worked. The new ones are marvels of technology, of course. Hey, there's the Oscar Mayer Wienermobile. So, 1952 Wienermobile. In 1936, the Oscar Mayer Company began to promote their hot dogs on the streets of Chicago with the very first Wienermobile. The only 1952 model in its original design, the Wienermobile in our collection served as a prototype for the more recent 1988 fleet. The Wienermobile reflects an innovative combination of transportation and product promotion. And yes, they do have a cafeteria of sorts in here. You can get a bite to eat. And it does look like it is open. I'm gonna have to go in there even though it's... I haven't had anything to eat today, including my drive from the Chicago area. I always like a good steam tractor, and this is an Avery steam traction engine from 1916 or thereabouts. These could pull implements, but they weren't normally used to go up and down the rows of the fields, although they could. A lot of the time they were just driven to a location and then used to provide power from a belt to stationary but seasonal equipment, such as threshing machines and so on. But it could pull a plow, and this one was capable of pulling a gang plow with as many as 8 bottoms across large farm fields. So, and then at harvest it could run a threshing machine or other things. The old relatives I had before they passed away used to talk about their days doing that. And at least where they lived, people still mostly used horse-drawn plowing implements instead of steam tractors because they were too few and far between, and most farmers still had the horses. But when it came to threshing, then they would lease or, you know, rent a steam tractor to come in that would just make the rounds and do a whole bunch of farms one day after another. Simple threshing machine from 1840. Portable combined thresher separator from 1870. A New Holland forage harvester, model 600, circa 1952. This with a row crop attachment could cut green corn, chop it, and blew it into a wagon hitch to the harvester. Other attachments harvested grasses or legumes. Legumes. Farmers blew the chopped material into a silo where the airless space preserved the livestock feed. That is an activity I never got involved with, even though they did do it. I just was never there at the right time. Automatic pickup baler from 1943. I always thought this is one of the most ingenious things, is the machine, not the part of it that brought the hay in and pressed it and formed it, but the mechanism right about here that wrapped the twine around the bales as they were compacted and tied them tightly. Just a very clever little gear-driven mechanisms there that would do that. And I don't think they changed all that much, even on the newer ones. Now this one doesn't appear to have a kicker on it. The ones that we operated had a kicker on it that was hydraulically operated. They also had a model that was mechanically operated off the power takeoff. And then it either had a crank or a hydraulically operated steering mechanism, so you could place the kicked bales wherever you wanted in the trailing wagon. You could do it all by yourself, didn't need any help. But on our farm, we always had some poor teenage kid or two who would come out and ride in the trailer and dodge the incoming, often 90-pound bales sailing in over their heads, and they would stack them so they could get more in the trailer. Anyway, so much for that. This is an Alice Chalmers 1018 tractor from 1914. And a Bryan steam tractor from 1924. A steam traction engine from 1886 by the Altman and Taylor Company of Mansfield, Ohio. This is a Ford 8N tractor, 1952. I always thought the Ford tractors looked kind of dumb, but apparently they were actually pretty good machines. A Page tobacco harvester. What did this have? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 guys could ride along here as it got pulled across the fields, harvesting the tobacco. Some cloth sunshades. And what's this guy here? Self-propelled cotton picker from 1950. From the Ben Pearson Manufacturing Company. This is an actual microscope used by John Washington Carver, circa 1900. He was the first African American to earn an advanced degree in agricultural science. And he did a lot of work on documenting the cellular structure of sweet potatoes, peanuts, and other crops that nurtured the soil and could be converted into industrial products. A beam scale, maybe 1860-ish, and a large cotton bale, and a cotton ginning, carding, and spinning machine. 1835 to 1840 thereabouts, and a cotton gin from around 1830. It's one of the things you had to know in grade school when I was a kid. You had to know cotton gin and Eli Whitney. If you didn't know that, you failed history. Here's a tomato harvester. An FMC model 2000 Cascade tomato harvester from 1969. Model of a silo. Industrial harvester model AW truck from 1912. With milk cans on the back. And an American cow milker. I guess it didn't work on European cows, huh? Ferguson Brown tractor from 1938. From Huddersfield, West Yorkshire, England. So it's a British tractor. And a Ford tractor with Ferguson System 9N prototype, 1939. You always have to have a John Deere somewhere in any tractor collection. John Deere Model B tractor, 1941. One of the most popular row crop tractors, selling roughly 300,000 of them between 1935 and 1952. See, this is a Fordson tractor, 1917 to 1918, that is, as used by Luther Burbank, pulling a Oliver Model 7A tractor drawn gang plow from 1927. And there's a Caterpillar Model 10 tractor from 1929. Looks like a John Deere corn planter, am I right? No-till planter from 1978. John Deere Model 7000. Experiments in planting into unplowed ground began in the 1950s to reduce wind and water erosion and retain soil moisture and improve soil health. This tractor-drawn planter cut a trench into the ground with rolling discs to drop the seed and dry fertilizer from hoppers into the trench. Rolling discs recovered the seed. No-till does not mean no chemicals, however. This no-till planter can also apply insecticides. This is a corn planter from 1875. This is a Superior grain drill, circa 1900s. These are mechanical planters called drills, distributed grass and grain seeds accurately and evenly across fields. These are models of stump pullers and rock lifters. And back here is a one horse grain drill circa 1870. There's a nice cutaway of a Fordson tractor. It's a 1926 model. And a John Deere moldboard plow from 1845. And an Oliver chilled cast iron plow from 1895. And a moldboard plow from 1775. And this is a International Harvester manure spreader back there from about 1905. And this is a spike tooth harrow from 1890. A model of a plow. This is a Westinghouse portable steam engine number 345 used by Henry Ford. And this is an experimental Ford lightweight tractor from 1907.